Federal police have released the images of seven men wanted after displaying terrorist symbols at a rally in Melbourne. Mark Santomartino with more.
Both the flag of Hezbollah and the face of its slain leader were paraded through the streets of Melbourne last weekend. Images linked to a classified terrorist organisation that Australia's federal police are now cracking down on. The agency has released the images of seven men who are believed to be linked to those displays of illegal symbols that were in the crowd in the CBD last Sunday. Seven men now wanted for questioning. In a statement from the AFP, it says some may have been named publicly. However, it's believed those are false names. Now, Australia classified Hezbollah's military arm as a threat 21 years ago. And as of December 2021, the group in its entirety has been considered a terrorist operation. Its flag was absent from today's protests, as well as last night's march from the Victoria Barracks to Spencer Street. But there is concern that the images might reappear at tomorrow's rally on the eve of the anniversary of Hamas's deadly October 7 attack.
October 7 isn't a day for celebration, it's not even a day for commemoration.
That is a culturally complex topic, fueled by a lot of trauma internationally, but the group is trying to comply with laws as much as possible.
Police have warned that they will show zero tolerance for any illegal behaviour at tomorrow's rallies or those vigils planned for October 7 on Monday, saying it's a serious offence to either promote, encourage or praise terrorism. The protesters I've spoken to insist they just want a ceasefire now.
The ongoing violence in the Middle East has seen a rapid spike in the death toll as Israel trades fire with Hezbollah in Lebanon. Edward Godfrey reports from Tel Aviv.
It's been another brutal day of airstrikes in Lebanon, and they show no sign of slowing. And a new player has entered this war, Iraqi militants launching a drone which has killed two Israeli soldiers in northern Israel earlier today. It came after Iran's supreme leader called for Muslim unity, leading Friday prayers for the first time in years. There were chants of death to Israel from the crowds gathered in Tehran. Ayatollah Khamenei saying Iran's missile attack on Israel was completely legal and calling the US a rapid dog. Tensions are already extremely high here and right throughout the region. Iran threatening to strike Israel's energy sites if it retaliates for that missile barrage earlier in the week. Israel reportedly weighing up hitting Iran's oil fields. It's prompted this from the US president.
Israelis have not concluded what they're going to do in terms of a strike. That's under discussion. I think there are, if I were in their shoes, I'd be thinking about other alternatives than striking oil fields.
Parts of Lebanon have copped a hammering again. There have been plenty of strikes in Beirut, and residents in the country's south have been evacuated or warned to leave from even more towns. Hezbollah has been firing rockets into Israel consistently throughout the day. Another 222 projectiles, according to the IDF. We saw some of those in Haifa. We've spent the day moving through northern Israel, fairly close, very close to the Lebanese border, entering some of the evacuated towns. We've seen a very heavy military presence and lots of tanks moving forward over the hill to join that ground incursion in southern Lebanon. A very tense situation on both sides and more broadly throughout the region in this war that has multiple fronts and once again is at a very critical point.
Elon Musk will join Donald Trump when the former president returns to Butler, Pennsylvania tomorrow, the site where a would-be assassin almost killed him. Jonathan Kersley has the details.
The stars and stripes of the American flag have returned to the farm grounds here in Butler, Pennsylvania, and so too soon will former President Donald Trump, returning to the site of the first attempt on his life to, he says, finish the rally he started. It was back in July. He was standing on the stage just a few hundred metres behind me underneath that very flag when Thomas Matthew Crooks managed to scale a building just a few hundred metres away and open fire, coming within centimetres of killing the former president. Thousands of people are expected here at this rally tomorrow. Some have already travelled thousands of kilometres. Mark came from California just to see tomorrow's event.
I feel awesome. I mean, I'm glad I could be here.
We also met Chloe, a young woman selling Trump-themed merchandise, much of it emblazoned with that now historic image. She was inside this rally when those shots rang out in July.
Are they going to make us look that weak a second time? I don't think so.
The security failings following the attempted assassination have been exposed, and Donald Trump's security has increased since that day. Today, the access road to the building where Thomas Matthew Crooks fired from is now surrounded by police caution tape. And tomorrow, the security around this event is expected to be incredibly high. The FBI and Department of Homeland Security has already warned there's an increased risk of political violence in the weeks ahead leading to the election. Today, President Joe Biden made an unannounced stop into the White House press briefing room, where he was asked about his concerns over whether the election would be peaceful.
I don't know whether it'll be peaceful. The things that Trump has said and the things that he said last time out, when he didn't like the outcome of the election, were very dangerous.
Tomorrow's rally from Donald Trump here in Butler, Pennsylvania, will come exactly 1 month until Americans decide who will be their next commander-in-chief. Donald Trump or Kamala Harris.
The Prime Minister has written to state and territory leaders asking them for input on a potential social media ban for young teens. Amanda Kopp with the latest from Canberra.
Prime Minister Anthony Albanese is moving ahead with his plans to get kids off social media, writing to state and territory premiers and chief ministers on how best to introduce a minimum age for platforms like Facebook, TikTok and Instagram. Still to be worked out are questions around what age is appropriate for a ban, perhaps somewhere between 14 and 16, as well as what role parental consent could play.
Parents need additional support because it's very hard to say to your child they can't when they say everyone else does.
We know that it is doing harm, particularly to young people, and we can't just sit by and do nothing about it. It's not about punishing them, it is about protecting them from the harms that it is doing.
Earlier this week, mental health groups pushed back against proposed bans, saying social media was an integral part of children's lives and that taking it away could lead to more harm than good. However, the government is looking at whether a phased-in approach is the best way to deal with children who are already on social media. Next week, the South Australian government, which has been at the forefront of this conversation, will bring together experts for a two-day social media summit in Adelaide and Sydney, making it clear the states and the federal government are determined to act, with Anthony Albanese vowing to introduce legislation to Parliament before the end of the year.